Hey everybody, good afternoon. Not good morning, good afternoon. We're live at 1:30 Pacific time and the end of your day at 4:30 on the East Coast with my co-host, Matt. Matt, good afternoon. How you doing?
Great afternoon. I'm doing good. Thanks. You?
Good. I'm doing pretty good. Absolutely. And in fact, as we'll talk about, our guest gave me a special treat last night. I was able to eat some popcorn, some CBD mushroom infused popcorn. I'll share my experience a little bit later, but today I'm doing great, feeling awesome. In fact, yesterday I just coached our first flag football team, my first time coaching ever. I don't know if you've coached yet. No, I'm actually coaching without having kids in there. But they're like, what? I'm like, yeah, I got a kid. He's 3 years old. He's going to be in the program in 2 years. I'll make sure I'm ready. They're like, wow. So, I'm excited. It's cool. I just kind of getting into it. First and second graders. That's trying awesome. trying to organize them, right?
It's hard coaching your own kids. Just fair warning. I coached my daughter one summer for soccer, and I was like, never again.
Okay. Yeah. Well, and that's what it was like during COVID. Homeschooling? No way. Yeah. Sorry. They're gonna go listen to teachers way more than you. So anyway, I'm glad they're back to school soon. Anyway, we've got a really cool program today. We're talking about cannabis. Marijuana, and specifically, we have a client that's coming, has been waiting backstage. We're bringing him on shortly. His name is Mike Randall. He's the owner of Tasty Infusion, and it's a Washington State-based company, and they're doing all sorts of interesting stuff. We got them a patent just recently granted, and I'll go through that patent with any of the live viewers. So we're talking patents, trademarks, copyrights, trade secrets. Any live question is fair game. I see a couple of live viewers on already. We're going to go through our first initial segment where I'm going to offer a free 20-minute free screening session. That's all of our clients. We kind of screen them to see if this is a good fit for you and a good fit for us. If you think now you've got something interesting you want to try to protect on the trademark side, a logo, a wordmark, or you have an invention and you kind of want to see if it's the right time to move forward, click that link right there. It's our weekly live link. You're going to get a copy of this book behind me, Bold Ideas, The Inventor's Guide to Patents. It's a book that I just updated last year, the second edition. So have a look. All right. Hey, Tina, good to see you. Steven, glad you guys are here. Awesome to have you guys on board. Again, we'll prioritize any live questions you've got. This is a live broadcast. That's what it's all about. We're going on Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn. So we'll welcome you guys across the board. We got Tina Hook saying hi. Nice to see you. So what we'll do is I'll bring in our guest. I don't want to wait too much longer. Mike's been waiting patiently backstage, if you will. Mike, welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you.
Awesome to have you. I know your signal was a little bit low. We couldn't have you on video, but you were looking sharp when I did see you. Tell me, how have you...
He's a handsome fella for sure.
So, tell us a little about Tasty Infusion. What was sort of the spark that got it going? What is it that you wanted to get into this market for?
Well, I got in this market to really make people's lives better. I have a tear in my sciatic nerve. It's a half inch shorter. Back surgery caused the tear in the sciatic nerve. And I was put on high doses of pharmaceutical at and I've always been healthy and I couldn't take, so I started with CBD with the coffee and
popcorn. CBD, you said? To
CBD, and now CBG, and then as I'm educating myself and learning more as I build this process, adding iron and magnesium, like now we add elderberry, burdock root, black seed, lion's mane, and all that is important too because you need to recharge your cells in your body to heal. And that's what's so great about these products is they actually they help you heal. Let me see. I'm sorry. I'm getting a little lost.
You're doing fine. You're doing great.
So we started with that, and then I learned that the lion's mane and psilocybin, your brain gets a negative impact when you're in pain. So every time you're in pain, your brain gets a negative impact. But the current products in the market don't do anything about that. They give you a gummy bear and say, have a nice day. But we added the psilocybin, lion's mane, and that to it, and that has totally changed my life, where I haven't been on pain pills for, God, 5 years now.
That's amazing. I've heard some of this stuff. I mean, I did try it. You sent some to me. That was incredible. I was like a little worried. I mean, I'm not someone that does sort of, you know, any type of, you know, substance like that. And I told you, emailed you. I'm like, I'm kind of nervous. I don't know about this. My wife and I decided to split a bag, and these are micro doses. It's not like there's anything majorly, you know, out of control. It was just a calming feeling. It was a little bit warmer and comfortable. That's all I could say. And so I couldn't agree more with what you said. I have not gone through any type of, you know, pain like what you were describing, you know, sciatic nerve pain. Matt, I don't know if you've had anything like that in your life dealing with pain. I couldn't imagine. And so it's like, have you done, was that a nod? You've been through something like
yeah.
that?
Yeah. Yeah. I have as well. I used to have like chronic back pain, and turned out it was a gluten allergy. But yeah, I for like a decade with inflammation and, you know, inflammation response.
All right. And I mean, you don't have to share too much, but how did you remedy what you were doing there, Matt?
Yeah. So I had, you know, I'd seen doctors and, you know, physical therapists and orthopedics, and everyone was like, oh, there's nothing wrong. Can't see anything wrong with you. You know, you probably just pulled a muscle, you know, and ended up going on keto, which is like a high fat diet for weight loss purposes. And had a dietitian I was working with, and we were on this diet, and I wasn't eating carbs, wasn't eating gluten. And all that pain went away, like within a couple weeks. I was like, oh, I get it.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So that's how I stumbled into, you know, my recovery from, you know, chronic pain. But that was
awesome.
4 years ago, 5 years ago.
Yeah.
One thing about our products is they are all organic. It's raw infusion. So there's no chemicals, bioengineered food, or no processed food in any of our products. Everything is organic and raw. No distillates, no isolates, no extractions. Them three products are carcinogenic, and I don't believe in putting a carcinogenic product into your body, into the food supply.
Right on. I want to showcase your Instagram page here. I'll share this with the audience. And one longtime friends and colleagues, real quick, Carmen Dinesco commented that he uses cannabis for his autistic son. And then all kinds of different solutions for that. So thanks for sharing that, Carmine. Okay, let me share my screen. I want to show some of your products, because I'm not sure everybody understands what cannabis infusion really is. Maybe you could walk us through the process that you've actually got a patent on now. Congratulations, Mike. What is this infusion process? Tell everybody what this is about.
Well, it's using the fatty acid of the coconut oil as your transference of all molecules. Vitamins and minerals and THC, CBD, CBG. The CBG is really impressive because you actually feel it work, because like when you're taking CBD, that's the biggest complaint. Does it work? I don't feel it. I feel a little something, but when you get the right combo of the CBD, CBG combined together, you 100% get better effects and you actually feel better.
Wow. There you go. And it's pretty immediate. You feel it. It's not like it's helping. It's like, boom, almost like, you know, if you were taking a, you know, pharmaceutical.
Yeah. And the coconut oil gives you 100% digestibility of the product through your system. When you consume a carcinogenic, you're not consuming all that product. It gets stuck into your cells. So that's one thing good about coconut oil, as everybody knows, it's healthy for you. And it's the best conductor. I mean, I don't think we've done enough work with coconut oil and understanding what that really can do for our food supply, instead of consuming processed foods all day.
I think I saw chicken wings on there. This you can put it on a lot of things, right? You can cook with it, eat it up. Doesn't have to be dry snacks.
Absolutely, yeah. There's fries on there too.
That's awesome. Okay, I want to show off your patent a little bit. I know the hard work. We had Randy Fenton, our patent agent, and Huda Elgero work on this. So this was granted not too long ago. Patent number 11,266,159 to you, Michael Randall, out of Lake Bay, Washington. So this was issued on March 8th of this year, about 6 months ago or so. And the patent itself is on this two steps. Oil infused with cannabinoids, tongue twister. And then you basically use the food product with that oil. Combine it.
It's all raw infusion. So yeah, and then infusing the coconut oil into the raw products is where it's at. It gives the products a better tasting product. It gives you a better tasting product than the original product. And it's healthier for you. And 100% digestibility is very important.
That's awesome. Yeah, congrats on that. I mean, normally with method patents, you know, there are 10 or 20 steps to it. And they make them pretty challenging to enforce. Yours is extremely short with having two major steps in that process. It's going to be very, very good. Have you seen any infringers yet? Anybody pop up that are copycats that you're worried about?
Actually, you know what's funny about that is when we started this process, this is so easy for me. All this raw infusion is so, I just understand it. But no, because it's hard. Nobody can figure it out. But I'm sure somebody will. But right now, I haven't seen anybody. And I've talked to a lot of people, but people just don't understand it.
Okay. Let's talk about a little bit of your business plan here. I've got 3, 4, 5 minutes left. I want to hear what is your plan to go to market? Given different legal state laws, right? You know, it's obviously not a federally legal substance, but what are you doing within the state of Washington and beyond?
We're actually going to be starting production in Cali at Los Lilas Warehouse. We just raised some money, so production will be out of there. Thank you. Yeah. Then the THC side will be out in Cali too, or whatever state we choose, but we're starting in Cali.
All right, Mike, we got a live question for you. Have you licensed this to other distributors? Do you have any interest in doing so in the name of holistic products?
Yes, we will be going down the line once my executive team gets on board and we start figuring all this stuff out. We will be licensing out. And also our goal is to be an ingredient company. Let's get some real raw quality food into everybody's hands that can get it. So we hope to expand out like that. Yes.
Very cool. Tina Cook asks, what's the difference between a method patent and say a normal utility patent? Awesome question. So a method patent describes a series of steps. And that's what Mike owns here is the method of infusion. And so he has a series, I think it's about 6 steps that I was showing earlier, where he's got to, you know, have a certain amount of temperature. Let's see what it is exactly. Start with a cannabis plant material. You have to freeze it, grind it, provide an oil with certain temperatures, adding at least a certain amount of oil mixture, and then heating it, reheating it, freezing it, and then straining it out and putting it back into the actual end product. So I think it's a total of 7 steps, and that's what he owns, is that step. So no one else is allowed to practice those sets of steps to produce that product anywhere in the U.S. That's what he owns with that patent. Now, a more traditional style mechanical patent would be for a device, right? Or some sort of physical product. The only potential issue with that is that it's just one version, right? One piece of structure. Of course, it could be contrived and made up of different materials perhaps, but that's the exact structure and the shape of it. So you're somewhat limited with your domains. With a method, any amount of cannabis or a range of cannabis and different types of foods, as you saw, is all protected by the one method. So I think it's a great option to protect it using a method patent. Mike, okay, we want to go to our bold bite right now, and I'm going to have you be a part of this. What we do is every week here, we put on a quick short plug from Shark Tank, which I'm sure you're familiar with, ABC's show, and we critique it. We give a legal analysis on a specific product. I did try to find a cannabis product, and they have not done one yet. Okay. And there's kind of some spoopy ones out there, but this one is an edible product. I think it does have some parallels, and we can learn from it and kind of integrate what you're doing in the market with your own product. Okay. So let's jump to that right now. I'm going to switch audio, and then we'll come back to some questions.
All right, here we go. Hopefully this plays through. You guys hear me okay?
Yeah, loud and clear.
All right, let's do it.
Next up is a replacement for millions of disposables.
Hello, Sharks. My name is Dinesh Taripalli, co-founder of Incredible Eats, and I'm from planet Earth. I'm here to share 7% of equity of our incredible company for $500,000. Sharks, across the world, a staggering amount of people are eating their food with single-use plastic utensils. But why do we use something just for a few minutes if it's going to take hundreds of years to decompose? Sharks, that's a moment on the lips, but a lifetime in a landfill. That's why we came up with Incredible Cutlery, the world's first mass manufacturable, totally edible utensils.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Well, Sharks, now you may eat your spoon, eat your straw, eat your spork, and even eat your chopsticks. Need I say more? My question is not who wants to invest in us, but who would like to join us to save the planet one straw or one spoon at a time. Okay, Sharks, please try all our cutlery in different flavors with different types of food.
What are we eating here?
Who cares? I'm going to eat a spork. Dinesh, how long does it take for it to decompose?
So each spoon stays firm for up to 20 minutes in hot soups, like a hot food, and about an hour in an ice cream. So they're pretty stable enough for you to eat with it and then eat it after.
This is very good.
Thank you.
And how many calories per chopstick?
Chopsticks are about 15 calories.
I had one spoon here and it was fantastic. It was like a spicy pizza flavored breadstick.
Tomato spice.
I would actually want to buy and eat these, not even as the utensil. Then this one was in the ice cream, and this one has a vanilla flavor and it tastes like a waffle cone. So this is delicious. Then we have here, what is this one?
That's a straw.
And what's the flavor?
It's actually flavorless.
So you are concerned about the flavor of these in addition to their functionality.
So our concept is to keep them subtle, because our initial first year of our sales was completely focused on food service, because that's where the heaviest usage of plastic is. And they wanted it to be very subtle, not too overbearing, because they don't want to change the food you eat with.
Right.
What does it cost for you to make it, and what are you selling it for?
About 20 cents. Mm-hmm. To buy the spoon, and our cost of goods is 10 cents.
What cost differential would it be between very large volume of plastic spoons versus this edible spoon?
Yes, a plastic spoon trends around 1 to 2 cents per spoon, but our product has a capability to make additional profits to the company. Let's say, for example, a very large ice cream chain ordered 100 million spoons. If they upsell it to their consumer for 5 cents, they make 5 million profit, and we also make profits.
But what would it cost me if I didn't want to upsell? As a large ice cream company, I bought 100 million of these. What's my delta? What's my difference in price?
So we started with 35 cents. We already brought it down to 20 cents. We're going to bring it down to 15 cents.
That's pricey, I think.
But have you sold anything yet?
I sold 1.2 million spoons so far, 2 to 2.5 years.
What's that in dollars?
About $170,000.
That's it?
And where are you selling them?
So 2019, it was completely B2B food service.
All right, guys, let's bring it in. Bring it in. Incredible Eats. Matt, let's
start with you.
Yeah, I love it. It's super cool. We're on this, everyone's kind of transitioning to paper products and biodegradable spoons and, bamboo spoons or biodegradable straws, right? And like, for the most part, they're pretty garbage, right? So, cool. And what's nice to see too is that they have an actual application at the USPTO, and it's basically published for opposition at this point, meaning that they're gonna get the registration if they follow through with the application. So yeah, super cool. one thing that I'll note too is that typically when clients, you know, work with us, there's these 45 classes of goods and services on the trademark side of the USPTO. And if you're a product company, you typically apply for the product and then potentially also the online retail store services that sell the product. So these folks at Incredible Eats, I'd recommend if they haven't already applied, which it looks like they haven't, they definitely apply for a class 35 application to protect the online and the wholesale distribution of their product. Because last thing you want is somebody else coming around calling themselves Incredible and kind of playing in this food service world.
Right. I like the kind of the double play on words, right? The Incredible with the edible, right? Eating the spoon. Pretty amazing. Yeah, I like it a lot.
It's good branding. It's good branding for sure.
I agree. On the patent side, quickly, I want to critique a little bit. You know, one part later in the segment, I didn't want to drag you guys on through that program too much longer. He did say, yeah, the patent. I always question that on the show. They don't have a patent yet, okay? They're still pending with their application. A lot of people say that I've got a patent, right? And Mike will be probably sure to tell you that, no, you don't have a patent until it's granted, because you got to work through the patent office, go back and forth with the examiner, prove to them that it truly is unique. Now, I'll ask you, Mike, since I haven't heard from you yet, what do you think they got a patent on? Do you think it was the actual, you know, spoons, utensils, spork?
That they're allowed to eat the spoon, the eating of the spoon, the materials that's made out of to be able to consume that spoon. But on mine, I was lucky because all 20 of my claims went through on the first try.
That tells you there's no one else doing what you're doing, which is extremely rare. And so, I mean, I think that's a testament to what you've done and your discoveries with the infusion aspect. With these guys, you hit the nail on the head. They did not get a patent on this on one particular design or a utensil. They got a patent on a method of using it and the actual substance of the actual, you know, formulation of that, which is a mixture of wheat and a binding agent. So if they get a patent on this, it could be pretty darn substantial. So they went for both the method like you did, but they're trying for, you know, kind of the moonshot, which is actually getting the substance itself. And what they wrote in their first claim is extremely broad. I want to share this with you guys just because it's one of the broadest attempts at getting a patent I've ever seen on an edible. So you see this claim one, a piece of edible cutlery, the piece of edible cutlery comprising a main flower and a binder. That's it. So they're trying to claim edible cutlery. As long as it has a flower and a binder, they're trying to own it. So that's probably why they're still stuck in pending. They probably bit off a little more they can chew, pun intended, on that aspect. So that's my critique of their current applications. It's probably a little bit too broad. You can see what they did down below, and they finally got a little bit more realistic and had described the percentage of each element, right? 80% to 90% of wheat, 0.8% to 8% of different types of flours, right? Corn or flour or chickpea, and describe how they're being binded in the later claims. And then they have the method of manufacturing it as well. It's another side claim. Mike, I want to get your reactions on the company and that pitch to the sharks. Any critiques or input there?
Oh, man. I think the guy did a great job. I love his product. I mean, it makes sense. Why do we throw everything out? Why do we use it something one time and then throw it in the trash?
Yeah, totally.
I love what he's doing, and I hope he becomes successful. How fun would it be to go to a restaurant and eat your fork and spoon when you're done?
Exactly. It's clean. We had a couple questions come in from our live audience. I'll make sure we get to them. Steven had a follow-up question for you, Mike. This one's a good one. He said, what were the challenges that you faced in generating revenue with a regulated substance? That would be fairly simple with other industries. So what sort of hurdles did you have to clear before you went to market?
I don't have much hurdles. I've been in the medical marijuana game. I started in the medical marijuana game with my coconut oil. That's how this all started. I've been a medical marijuana patient for a long time. So I've always grown my own medicine and had access to tons of it. And that part was actually easy for me, because the cost does rise real fast in DNR and research. So that part was easy. And I've always been connected into that world with all my friends and stuff. So that cool. I was blessed on that.
Right on, right on. Well, that's an easy answer there. You've been in this for a while. This is not your first time at going after this type of product.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's why I came in here actually, is because all the edibles and the iceless distillates and extractions they're putting into these nasty edibles, I want to bring something that really makes you feel good and you don't crash in 2 hours and you're eating something healthy.
Hey, I want to do this with a quick question here on trademarks for you, Matt. KFC, one of my favorite examples. So how do you go forward with trademarking an acronym? And this is a good point for Mike too. He's got the TI. But for this question, yeah. Example, KFC.
Yeah.
How do you get an actual mark or registration for an acronym, or can you?
Yeah, absolutely. 100%. I guarantee KFC does have an acronym registered at the United States Patent Trademark Office, probably for the marketing, for the food product, you know, probably for toys. I mean, you name it, they're going to be all over the place. But a lot of times what clients will do is they'll have a brand, you know, Kentucky Fried Chicken, which, you know, if it wasn't famous or so well known, would be descriptive, right? But they would also have like a registration for the acronym. They're going to have a registration for the logo, which probably includes KFC along with Kentucky Fried Chicken below it. So there's lots of ways that clients will go about registering acronyms as trademarks. And they do, you know, act as source indicators. So they are viable conceptual trademarks.
Perfect, perfect. There you go. There's your answer. We had one question come in, or one comment rather, from Tina. So she wants to talk about the racists controlling the approvals. My goodness. All right. And you're talking the patent office, I would assume, or others that control maybe the regulatory framework. I'm not sure exactly. Could you give us some more information on that? That's a pretty strong accusation. And we have another comment here, wrap up from Steve, and he didn't realize he had some typos there. So thank you for all that. Keep the questions coming. I want to bring those up if and when they're pertinent. We have a couple more minutes left, and I want to just show off your branding. Mike, we got you here. So I looked at your Instagram page briefly, and I showed that. Have you gone after a registration to try to protect the trademark?
Well, unfortunately, in the THC space, you can't trademark stuff. We're fortunate because we have regular products too. We have coffee and foods that and popcorn that are infused with elderberry, burdock root, black seed. So from what my executive team says, we're allowed to trademark that and then have a CBD company with it. But that's one of the holdups right now in the THC market and trademarking THC products, is they're not allowing it. But I'm learning about all that trademark stuff still. It's been quite an experience, but that's about the extent of my knowledge on it.
Yeah, we got a trademark expert here. Matt, give us some color there.
It's always interesting when new products kind of come to market at the United States Patent Trademark Office. You know, obviously marijuana, cannabis is a controlled substance, and so it's not able to be registered at the USPTO, whether product or products related to the ingestion or use or distribution of cannabis. But there are other products, right? There are products out there like CBD, like Delta 9, that are not regulated as heavily. And the USPTO has really struggled to be consistent in how it treats applications for those substances. I'll tell you, a few years ago, the USPTO was allowing CBD applications to go through the process and register, and then they held it up. So, you know, we have quite a few clients at this point who are kind of in limbo, having been denied by the USPTO, even though when we applied for the application, the USPTO was allowing those CBD applications to go through. You know, I've talked to a couple folks who work at the USPTO, and there's rumblings that that's going to change, and CBD might be allowed to register here at some point, but, you know, I haven't seen the proof yet.
Would you recommend elderberry? I mean, yeah. These things that sound like natural products.
Yep.
Could he get a registration for simple, you know, non-controlled substances now, and should he perhaps look into that and then 100%. Add those classes later?
100%. So that's what we end up doing for a lot of clients who are in this cannabis or CBD space, is that we're going to register, you know, products and services that are tangential to those products that we actually want to protect, basically to hold space until prohibition ends. you know, and I don't know what happened, but there's ways of securing your brand in this space that kind of skirt the USPTO, you know, I guess prohibition against CBD and things like that.
I think like you said, they're going to start doing it. They're missing out on so much money, and it just really makes no sense. If you're making weed legal, make it legal. Stop holding people back.
I've even heard someone at the USPTO who seems to think that the USPTO at some point here is going to allow trademark registrations for cannabis, which seems crazy to me, but this person works there and they seem to know what they're talking about. So it's definitely being considered.
Right. Yeah. I think at the highest level, perhaps maybe the policy is like on the patent side. Yep. We'll get you a patent. You're the only one able to make, use and sell this in the US, even though maybe some of these states you wouldn't legally be able to sell it. Right. Same on the trademark side. Yep. So wherever you are, make sure you're doing it legally within the state. Right. But from a federal standpoint, you've got your uniqueness, your registration, your distinctiveness. You meet all the requirements. So, guys, a half hour flew by. Before I wrap up, and Mike, I want to see if you are comfortable with me sharing your email address with our public here in case they want to follow up with you and maybe catch a little bit of mentorship from you. Maybe they're starting a new product. Are you open to that?
Oh, absolutely. If they want to try any products, I'm selling it. Hit me up on Instagram or hit me up on email and, you know, buy some product too. For real, best products you've ever had.
All right. Probably put your email right in there and I'm going to follow you at, this is tasty_infusion on Instagram. Yes. And for Matt and I, if you heard us say something, you want to talk to either one of us further, I'm going to put in our contact information, our emails here. Thank you all of you who stayed on and were on with us live, and thank you for those likes and hearts. That's great to see. We're here next week at 1:30 Pacific. If you missed us on our live program, we're here every Wednesday at 1:30 Pacific and 4:30 East Coast. It's been a pleasure having you on our show, Mike.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Have a good day, everybody. Go big, go bold.